I'm going to talk a little bit about DDN Infinia. So some people who are here for quite some while heard the name RED more often. So Infinia is the formal product name. Now that we get to the point where we actually do real deployments at customer sites, this is the name you should remember. For the people who heard it before, RED was the former product development cycle name, and Infinia is the product name that I'm going to talk about a little bit. So again, for the people who haven't heard much about it, I'm trying to do a very short summary of it. So Infinia is a from the ground up new development of a purely software-defined storage product. It is highly distributed and is really designed for AI and cloud, and I'm going to have a couple of examples on what that really means and why this is very different than things that we've done before. We have not really used any of the intellectual property in terms of code that we've developed before, but obviously we have a lot of very smart and bright people in the company, and we used and leveraged all the experience we have in order to build this new product. The thing that is different than most other data platforms is that Infinia is really built for structured as well as for unstructured data. So it has different interfaces in the various aspects. It is more delivered as a service. That doesn't mean it doesn't run on hardware. It doesn't mean that you can't deploy this for a single customer. But it has an incredibly strong service delivery aspect, all the way from the initial deployment of the software, all the way to the day-to-day work and how people interact with it. And one key thing was to build something that is incredibly simple. Particularly in the AI world, what we're seeing is there is a huge difference to HPC when it comes in terms of velocity of deployment. So when we're talking to some of these large AI customers, the speed that they operate on is very, very crazy. So you have talked to somebody, hey, we're going to build this, whatever, 25, 30, 40, 50 megawatt data center. We need to maximize what we can put into this. And by the way, it needs to be up and running in 5 months. So there is no RFP and, 15 rounds of negotiations and this and that. The speed of execution these people looking at is absolutely incredible. And therefore, one of the things they focus on is also, not just the typical things like density and floor space in this. It's all very, very important. But it also, how fast can I get it up and running, and how easy is it to operate on a day-to-day basis? These are two very, very key decision points for these people. So because of that, as I said, we've developed this new stack. So from an architectural point of view, the entire software is completely containerized, so that allows us essentially to deploy things more like a microservice. So you can start with a handful of nodes, and then you just dynamically expand the system, and you can basically ramp this to any size you want. It also allows you to not just do elastic scalability, it also allows you to actually shrink the system. So if you need less resources after you, removed some projects, you can also shrink the system. And the key thing is that everything in the system is really in an always-on state, which means no matter if you do an upgrade, it's online. If you do expansions, it's online. If you shrink the system, everything can be done online, without any disruption to the service, to the end user. It also means that if you're actually replacing all the hardware, everything happens online. So the whole lifecycle management of hardware is fully baked in. So you basically add new hardware to the system, you remove old hardware resources out of it, and everything always stays online, and the end user doesn't notice that you move from one platform to another platform, do an upgrade from PCIe Gen 4 to 5 to 6, whatever it's going to be. All of those things are done online without any disruption. Multi-tenancy is really truly baked in from an architectural point of view. So you basically take the entire capacity of the system and then you simply present to your individual users an SLA for performance and an SLA for capacity. So, and you can dynamically change this. So you can start with, your customer Coke. You add Coke to it, it gets 100% of the system, 100% performance, 100% capacity. So now you get user Pepsi coming on board and saying, hey, I need a slice of the system. You can basically remove unused space of Coke, give it to Pepsi, and essentially hand them an SLA for performance and capacity from the overall system. You can dynamically change those allocations on the fly because there is no allocation of any fixed resources to any customer. It's all completely dynamic and it's all completely virtualized. And unfortunately, the talk today doesn't allow enough time to go into the details, but we're more than happy to set up a technical session to explain that. The unstructured data has gotten a lot of interesting features from our side. What we foresaw already years ago in talking, you know, to some customers in HPC and at the time AI customers that were not called AI, which were just, you know, very fancy HPC customers at this point in time, was that they need to have a capability to do more with metadata. So it's no longer just the data that you store in the system, it's all about the metadata and how you can enrich data by adding more and more metadata over time. This could be something as simple as an autonomous car project. You take a picture, you want to record, what camera was it recorded with? What's the firmware, what's the hardware, what's the position? GPS, temperature, all these kind of things. People have stored that in a storage system alongside with a database, and what they want to do today is they want to bring both these worlds together, where you have data stored and enriched constantly with metadata, so it's easier to find it, easier to tag it, easier to automate it, add processes and policies around it. And so all of these things are basically built into the storage platform itself. So use cases can obviously be all over the place. As I said, it's highly centric for AI. That doesn't mean you can't use it for HPC. There's actually, in fact, several large-scale HPC projects that we're looking to as well. There's some capabilities that enables it to run in the edge, as well as in the data center and in the cloud, and always a single stack. Because of its containerized architecture, it's very easy to deploy everywhere. And I have a few examples on how low you can actually go from a hardware footprint, which allows you to actually just run it on a PCIe card, and I'm gonna show that in a few seconds as well. So the very first data service that is coming out with this product is essentially an object store access. So we've implemented the complete set of AWS S3 calls that exist. So we basically support the full round of all the S3 calls. But we implemented it in a way to be incredibly efficient. So if you compare Infinia's latency to AWS, we're talking about a roughly 100x difference in latency for individual S3 operations. So if you run a small number of servers with a very small queue depth of workload, you essentially see sub-millisecond latencies. We're talking about 450 microseconds for an S3 call. That is pretty much comparable to what a distributed file system can do in terms of latency. So essentially, we give you a storage system that has the simplicity, the ease of use of an object store, but it has latency possibilities that before were only achievable by distributed storage systems like, you know, an exascaler system or similar. And so it is very well suited for interactive workloads, you know, at very low latency requirements. That very small cluster that you see here gets over 300,000 GET operations per second and allows you to basically, you know, scale up or improve the performance of any existing object store you have, and supports a lot of you know, modern upcoming workloads and frameworks simply because of the very rich S3 API capabilities the product provides. For the people who don't know anything about BlueField, so BlueField is an advanced card from NVIDIA. We're working with the BlueField team for a very, very long time together already. And so this is one of the cards that I mentioned before where you can run the stack on. A BlueField card basically has a handful of ARM cores that are on the network adapter itself. And we work very close with NVIDIA together in order to be able to run some of the acceleration and offloading functions on the BlueField adapter itself. And I have actually one or two examples of that. So here is an example where you have a host on the top which runs an application. And then you have a BlueField adapter inside the host. And what you can obviously do is you can just run a straight application. It uses put and get operations over the network. It talks to an Infinia system that is on the other side, which basically speaks the S3 protocol. And that allows you to just run something without any changes to an application that already speaks S3. What we've done then together with NVIDIA is we basically moved some portion of the storage system, which in this case is primarily the S3 server side, into the compute host itself. So essentially, every compute node gets its own S3 server because it runs in a network card that is physically plugged into the client itself. So the benefits you get from this now is that you get super, super low latency S3 performance because you're basically talking over the loopback network to your own network adapter in your own box. But then the BlueField adapter can use RDMA erasure-coded compression, all the enterprise features that the Infinia product has, to talk over the network to an Infinia system that is on the other side of the wire. So essentially, you're giving RDMA enablement for an S3 workload over the network. And you eliminate a second network hop that you get with other products that speak S3, because typically your client sends something to a server, the server does erasure coding over another network to other nodes. So all of these steps basically completely are eliminated, and you go straight from the application into the BlueField, and the BlueField does all the offloading in order to basically optimize the network traffic to the remote storage system. So we're in the process of deploying a very large-scale system. So Infinia has not formally GA'd yet. The reason for that is we try to push this out as long as we technically can, so we can get a very good quality product that works very well from day one. We convinced the customer at a very large scale to basically be the first production implementation of this product. The system has roughly 1,000 Infinia servers into the initial deployment. You see here, this is one of multiple data halls where that system goes into, and the workload is primarily data ingest via S3, and then we've built some high-performance integration with Spark, where the customer has thousands of GPU nodes that basically use our highly optimized Spark version, which basically bypasses S3 altogether. It can talk straight from the Spark application with the backend storage systems, not using any intermediary protocol. And that gives the customer a massive advantage in terms of processing time. And that is the first system that we're going to go live with over the next 2 to 3 months. So it's obviously a very big challenge to go from a non-GA product to 1,000 systems in production. But that is also something that will allow us to focus extremely on one customer, make this use case very, very fast, very, very robust, and then can deploy this on multiple other customers after that at similar scale. So the way this integration works is we basically took Spark, and because of the containerization and the flexibility of the way Infinia is implemented, the entire Infinia software stack is implemented in a library. It's completely in user space. There is no kernel component to it. And so what we've basically done is we wrote a custom backend for Spark so that the Spark analytics framework can just make calls to the Red library. And then the Red library, which implements all the RDMA handling, the buffer management, the network handling, is basically executed as part of Spark. And so if you do a read or write request, essentially does the erasure coding over the network straight to just the Infinia nodes that hold the media inside. And so that cuts all of these middle layers, multiple network hops. It simplifies the memory management because there is no copies of individual memory buffers. So mem copies are almost entirely eliminated. And that gives you the most optimized way to actually interact from the application with the storage system. And that is this very specific way we interact from Spark point of view for this particular customer. So as you know, DDN is built for scale. And we really take these challenges in the new world of AI. And so we really keep both products going forward. We have a very, very strong roadmap for Exascaler as well as for Infinia. We clearly see that Exascaler will continue to solve the problem of extreme scale. So if you need very, very large scale systems where you have highest throughput per rack space, very, very high density, very, very high bandwidth and IOPS, we will continue supporting this with Exascaler going forward. While on the Infinia side, we focus more on data distribution, the whole governance model, as I just said, managing around metadata, enriching data with structured and unstructured data at the same time. Very extreme multi-tenancy capabilities that are provided here. And there is a lot of future development around data management and making this very tightly integrated with customers' application. And I just wanted to share that as kind of a positioning so people understand where the train on both sides goes. They both have very, very strong engineering teams, very, very strong funding behind them, and we plan to continue run them in parallel for two very different use cases, and so they will be very complementary to each other, and you will see this particular with some of the advanced roadmap items that are coming down the road.